enjoy the fellowship, to enjoy the meal, and to enjoy the entertainment that you will see coming very shortly. As you all know, this is a fundraiser for to raise some cash for the new air conditioner. Seems kind of funny to be talking about air conditioning. Kind of just going through one of the coldest winters we've ever had. You know, it's just so cold out there. You know me, I'm always cold. When everyone asks me, I'm always cold. Does anybody want to ask me how cold? I thought you'd never ask. It was so cold. I saw a hitchhiker hold up a picture of his thumb. It's so cold outside. I saw a Greyhound bus, and the dog was riding inside. You know, the other day I like my hot coffee in the morning. The other day somebody spilled hot coffee on my hands, and I said, thank you. And this cold is not just limited to our part of the country here. For instance, in Southern California, Miley Cyrus was stuck to her wrecking ball. On the farms in Wisconsin, cows were getting ice cream instead of milk. My ice cubes had goosebumps. This monologue is going down.
It's good.
It's good.
Thank you, Bart. It's so cold. I saw a group of polar bears wearing Under Armour. And finally, out of Hell, Michigan, mm-hmm. It has finally come to pass. It has frozen cold. And that's enough for the monologue. Our first act this evening is our own Miss Vicki Haynes. She is going to be entertaining us. So, with no further ado, is Vicki Haynes.
Thank you.
College graduate remembers 5 years after he's out of college. It'll cost them like $20. $20 may seem like a lot of money, but it includes everything. It includes their tuition, their cap and gown rental, their graduation picture, snacks, everything. Everything's all included. And you know how in college you gotta take a 2 years of foreign language? Well, in my 5 minute university, you could take pick any language you like. For example, suppose you want to take Spanish. In Spanish, I teach you ¿Cómo está usted? Which means, how are you? The answer, muy bien. And that's all you need to know. If you take the 2 years of college Spanish, 5 years after you're out of college, all you're going to remember is ¿Cómo está usted? And muy bien. So in my university, you don't have to take all that conjugation and the vocabulary and all that other crap. You won't remember it anyway. Economics. You've got to study economics. All you need to know in economics, supply and demand. In a business, you buy something and you sell it for more. That's it. And I have a theology department in my 5 minute university. I'm a priest, so it's only 50. And in the theology department, you need to know the answer to one question. Where is God? And the answer is, God is everywhere. Why? Because He likes you. That's a combination of the Disney and the Lord Catholic philosophy. Just perfect for this 21st century. Then once the classes are all done, it's time for a little Easter vacation. Won't have the time to go to Fort Lauderdale. Only lasts like a 20 seconds. I'll turn on a little meat lamp for you. Pour a little glass of orange juice, that's in the snack department. You drink the orange juice, and then it's time for the final exams. I say to you, ¿cómo está usted? You say, muy bien. Thank you. I say, economics? You say, supply and demand. Where is God?
Everywhere.
You put on a little patent gown. I get out my little Polaroid camera, take a snap, flash a picture. I give you the picture. You give me the $20. I give you your diploma. And now you're a college graduate, ready to go. All there is to it. And I'm thinking, I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure, I'm going to start a little law school right next door to the Five Minute University. You got another minute? Thank you.
Our next act, as I read once again, the Gospel Gal.
Directions.
Okay, panel's coming up. Minor technical difficulty.
Okay, there was a technical difficulty today, too.
Yes, being just in the audience would be really good, I think.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, this next day. Unfortunately, I think that it's gotten old. It's no longer cold. You have to think summer.
Air conditioning.
And speaking of air conditioning, just as a reminder, back on the near the kitchen door is the nice makeshift air conditioner that Carl put together. So it's long to be filled. Well, it looks like our next act is just about ready to roll. And the lollipop ladies, what a transformation.
Southern country style, which means when I was a pastor down in Southern Ohio, you know, we had to kind of make things, you know, kind of in the culture and stuff. So hopefully some of you city folk, you know, heard some of these songs, or else this might be kind of a long and desperately mind-numbingly boring show. But anyway, so hopefully you can follow along. But so we tried to make the Lutheran Confessions and put it to some local music. So the first one that we came up with was the story of Martin Luther. So I should say that there are three things that you need to remember with Lutheran Confessions. So Lutherans believe in what's called that the Word of God comes to us as law and gospel, that we believe that people are justified by faith through grace, and that we believe in what's called the theology of the cross. And if you listen closely, you'll hear all three of those things in all these songs. There also is a prize to anybody who can successfully name the song and the writer of every song that I sing this evening. So the first one was we told the story of Martin Luther. So Martin Luther was born in Eisel-Blasen, I can't pronounce German, but Germany. But anyway, it's in Saxony, which is, I think, in eastern Germany. So we came up, with the song, and it was about, you know, God bless Saxony. His own hand brought them down, angels from the promised land. And gave him Martin Luther, here I stand. If you want to see heaven, saved by grace is your chance. Well, I've been sent to spread the message. God bless Saxony. Okay, so that was the first one. So the second thing is, well, now Pastor John, I'm sorry, but I'm about to out you on this one. So the other thing is that I have a confession to make, which is that all of us pastors have been lying to you for a very long time. Pretty much hundreds of years. Pretty much ever since the Reformation. So you may have heard when you were little kids the story about how Martin Luther became a monk. You know, he's walking down this street. This big thunderstorm comes. Now, you have to remember that they didn't really have artificial lighting back in the 16th century. So if it was dark out like it is right now, it was really dark. You couldn't see a thing, you know, you couldn't see a thing in front of you. So all of a sudden, this big storm comes, and there's, like, lightning and flashing, and clouds are going boom and everything. Yeah, it's pretty scary. And if you, you know, don't know that this is a natural weather phenomenon, you kind of get the idea that maybe God is really, you know, ticked off at you. So, you know, Martin Luther's walking down the street according to the story, and he's trying to get home, and he's running probably because it's raining cats and dogs and all this, and you know, it's just all over, and the lightning's coming, and boom, 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 and he's like, I'll become an Augustinian. So anyway, that was his deal with God. He was trying to become a lawyer, and he decided to become an Augustinian monk. So that's the story. But it didn't really happen like that. That was the lie. That was the myth. What really happened is, like most things with Martin Luther, it had to do with the devil. You ever heard the story? You heard the story about Martin Luther, and he's like lying awake, or he's lying in his bed, and he wakes up, and there's Satan that's like sitting at the other end of his bed. And he looks up and goes, oh, it's just you. So apparently that's a true story. But anyway, so like most things with Martin Luther, it had to do with the devil. Well, you see, one day the devil was going down to Saxony. And the devil was looking for a soul to steal. And he was in a bind, because he was way behind, and he was willing to make a deal. When he came upon this little boy, terrorizing his soul and terrorizing it hot, and the devil jumped on a hickory stump and said, boy, let me tell you what. I bet you didn't know it, but I'm a soul terrorizing man too. If you care to make a dare, well, I'll make a bet with you. Well, you terrorize your soul pretty good, boy. Give the devil his due. I got a heaven of gold. Against your soul, says I'm better than you. Well, that boy said, my name's Martin, and it might be a sin, but I done take your bet, you're gonna regret. I'm the best there's ever been. Oh, Martin terrorize your soul and terrorize it hot. This hell's recluse in Saxony like the fire that fell on Lot. And if you win, you get this shiny heaven made of gold. But if you lose, the devil gets your soul. Blah, 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 blah. Well, the devil got in, he got ready to go, and he fired up his something or other, and he got ready to go, and a band of demons joined in, and it sounded something like this. I was around St. Petersburg when I saw it was time for change. I killed the Tsar and his ministers, Anastasia screamed in rage. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guess my name. Woo woo! Woo woo! Because what puzzling you is the nature of my game. Woo woo! Woo woo! When the devil got done, Martin said, well, you're pretty good, old son. But sit you in that chair right there, let me show you how it's done. He played, mighty fortress is our God. Borgin never fails. Jesus Christ is our only Lord. That's all the gospel it entails. Mighty fortress is our God. Borgin never fails. Jesus Christ is our only Lord. That's all the gospel it entails. When Martin got done, well, the devil knew that he'd been beaten. He laid that golden heaven down to the ground at Martin's feet. Martin said, hey, devil, you come on back if you ever want to try again. As I done told you once, you son of a gun, I'm the best there's ever been. He said, my fortress is our God. Borgin never fails. Jesus Christ, our only Lord. That's all the gospel it entails. The mighty fortress is our God. Borgin never fails. And Jesus Christ, our only Lord. That's all the gospel it entails. So that was the second song. So for the final thing that we used to teach down in Southern Ohio, in case you're wondering, I never actually sang this in Southern Ohio. But the third thing that we used to teach them was, you know, people are always wondering about, so all of us, you know, this is great, what, you know, Martin Luther and what God does to us, and Jesus Christ and the gospel and all that. But how am I supposed to live my life? You know, how do, as ministers, how do we like our Lutherans to live? So we came up with a song for that. And that one goes like this. It goes, well, I like my Lutherans just a little on the graceful side. When they're saved by grace through faith and they do abide to the teachings of Holy Scripture, and I believe in something like the rapture. Yeah, I like my Lutherans crazy and I like them wild. Should've seen the look on the face of my dad and mom when I came home from Sunday school and told them about Doubting Tom. My dad said, excuse me, son, but that faith's not about belief. It's about the Word of God, which is supposed to bring relief. And I said, yeah, ain't it cool, Dad? Well, that's the kind I like, because I like the Lutherans just a little on the graceful side. When they're saved by grace through faith and they do abide and to the teachings of Holy Scripture, and I believe in something like nature. Yeah, I like the Lutherans crazy, and I like them wild. So there you have it, the Lutherans.
Sacred of the Sage, written by the Reverend William Barton. This parable is called The Moth in the Church Carpet. There was a moth that had his home in the sanctuary, and he lived long and was happy, for the place of his habitation was between two tacks in the edge of the carpet, in an obscure little angle where the stair ascended onto the pulpit. And it would have been difficult to select a finer place of abode for a moth of sedentary habits. And he never, never wandered from his own fireside, but brightened the corner where he was. That is to say, he wandered not until the time when this chapter in his history beginneth. And this chapter is not a long one, and there will not be any chapters after this. For that moth is there no longer, and the place that knew him knoweth him no more. Now this moth was serenely happy, for the carpet was fuzzy, and it was the very best food a moth could desire, and the brushes of the janitor came not nigh him. And the moth listened unto the organ, and he thought the music was for his edification. And he heard the sermons and the prayers, and so far as he knew, they were addressed to him. And he lifted up his eyes, and behold, there were yards and yards of carpet stretching down long aisles through the length of the nave. And he looked unto the right hand and the left, and there was carpet unto the uttermost borders of the transepts. And the vines had fallen unto him in pleasant places, and he had a goodly heritage. But he waxed fat and grew conceited, and he said, go to now, I will explore my heritage, for behold, all this is mine, and for me it hath been created. And he crept out of his corner and started on a journey down the center aisle. And when he had gotten out about an inch and a half of an inch, behold, the janitor came along with a vacuum cleaner. And just what happened unto the moth, he hath not yet clearly defined in his own mind. For he was sucked up with a strong wind and pulled down a hollow rod and blown down a rubber tube that led to an iron pipe in a vat in the basement and buried deep in dust. And while he meditated, the janitor came and opened the vat and thrust in a shovel and scooped up the dust and shoveled it into the blazing fiery furnace. And the moth was in the dust when this occurred. And the history of that moth from that time on containeth nothing of importance. But there seldom hath been a moth whose future prospects were more encouraging than that one, if he had not gotten a swelled head and thought that he was boss of the whole establishment. Now the person who thinketh that the universe was made for his own convenience would better stay in his own little corner of it. For if he getteth out where important things occur, something is likely to happen either to him or to his theory.
There's just a host of talent in this congregation.
Tony Serafin here. Welcome. And welcome to our first video interview with Free Spirits from this church community. And I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Siegfried Oddity. And he has agreed to do an interview with us. Isn't that right, Dr. Oddity?
Yeah, I guess. Although I'm kind of tired today. In fact, I'm bushed.
Didn't you sleep well?
No, I made some mistakes. And I'm not seeing too well as well.
Why is that?
I think yesterday I was walking down the street and all of a sudden the prescription ran out, just like that.
Well, I'm sorry about that, but tell me, I've been told that you have an unusual kind of mind. Can you give us an example of that?
I don't know about that unusual, but it depends on what you mean by unusual, you know. Things that I think are very normal, straightforward, and started when I was, before I was born even. I had heard about this theory that the little babies in the mother's womb didn't have fingerprints, so I wanted to test it out, and I got out of my mother's womb, and I robbed banks and people's houses and got their name. It's right. Nobody could prove it. No fingerprints.
Well, and you thought that was normal. That's very strange indeed. Say, I've heard that you are an inventor, and I see some things here that looks like you've invented.
Yes, all sorts of high-tech things. You know, we got cordless phones, so you don't get tangled. And extension cords just always drive me crazy, so I invented the cordless extension cord. They're bridges. Everybody likes a drink nowadays. So I invented this beautiful, delicious vine.
Well, what makes that so unusual?
Well, I made this vine out of raisin, so you don't have to wait for it to age. Instant coffee, that's very normal, everyday coffee, but you put this coffee in a microwave oven and you go back in time.
Well, yes, I can imagine. And
they're very slow to understand.
And I see there's a beer there. What's that all about?
This beer also very normal. Ordinary everyday. You just get the copy machine, you push the button, you got another copy machine.
And
I think I perfected my camouflage sweater as well.
Oh, where's that?
You see?
Well, I can see you're very clever, and surely, as an inventor, most inventors have had problems along the way. Can you tell us of any difficulties?
Just last spring, I invented the bird seed, and I planted it, and up came a bird. The trouble is now I don't know what to feed it. And I'm invisible ink. At least I think I do, but that's the problem with this. He is so good, I don't know if I've run out of
now. I can only imagine. Any other difficulties?
The styrofoam peanuts I invented, but I didn't know how to ship them.
Do you have any inventions in the pipeline that you're working on, projects you're working on?
Well, yes, I always try to solve problems, you know. Like, I sometimes sit for a long time and I curl up my leg and then my foot falls asleep. I hate it when that happens because then I know it's going to be up all night. So I'm trying to figure out what to do about that.
Well, I can see that is a problem, but you know, the other thing is I was told that you are writing a book. Can you tell us about
that? I've already gotten the page number and stuff.
So you haven't put any ideas down on paper?
Yeah, I'm not thinking too clearly. My imagination's not working. You know, I try to daydream, for instance, but my mind keeps pondering.
Well, writing in the first place.
I wanted to always solve life's persistent problems, the things that trouble everybody, like the order of the alphabet, for instance. Does it come from that song that they sing? Or if you get scared, what happens when you get scared half to death twice? They say that when you butter the butter on the toast of the butter, if you drop it, it always falls on the butter side down. But they also say that cats always land on their feet. So what happens if you strap a piece of toast? And you're telling the horse, when you're in the woods and nobody's there to laugh, it's still a joke.
Well, all very important questions, I'm sure.
I get a bit of a
But is this book your very first writing project?
I years ago didn't write a book, but I wrote music. I wrote all kinds of music. The only trouble is I can't read music, so I didn't know what it was that I was writing. So now I'm driving down the street, I have the radio on, you know, I hear something, I think, did I write that?
Well, I hope you don't mind me asking, Doctor, but are you ever concerned that people might see you as a little weird?
Weird? I don't know. But sometimes, when I'm out of my right mind, my left mind gets very, very crowded.
I can imagine that's a sign. I understand that you live alone, and I assume that you're single. Have you ever had problems with relationships with women?
I was almost had a girlfriend who was psychic, but she left me before we even met.
Well, what about anybody right now that you're involved with?
It is a little difficult sometimes. I have a girlfriend, and she asked me to buy her some fingernail polish. Couldn't find anything in the past. I bought a whiteout. When she puts it, and then I sneak up into her bedroom at night and I put misspelled words on her fingernails, and it just drives her crazy.
Well, that's pretty strange. Well, we're really fresh out of time.
Wait a minute. That's strange to me, you see. You say we're out of time, but we've got plenty of time, and people have time, they say we're wasting time, and we're behind time, and I don't think people know. Do you know what time is?
Well, I'm sure you're going to tell. Would you tell this audience what you think time is?
Sure, I'll explain it to you. That was time.
Yep. Oh, very enlightening. Let's give a good hand to Dr.
Picture this, an island in the South Pacific during World War II. Nellie has just denounced the handsome French plantation owner Emile with a song called, "I'm Gonna Wash That Man Right Out of My Hair." When Emile comes riding down the beach on his horse, white of course, and is when and Nellie is and he asked Nellie to his home for a very important dinner party in her honor. She's reluctant at first, but he persists and finally asks her to marry him. She melts, as she knows she really does love him. And so the song begins as he rides off, forgetting his hat, of course. Thank you.
Sally. I've been waiting for this. This is just going to be great. So, without any further ado, it's the radio broadcast of Sally Seashore Seashell Shop. Okay, say that again. It's Sally Seashore Seashore Shop. Seashell Shop. Never mind. Sally's.
WSAL, where Sally's the subjects on Saturdays and Sundays.
Sally sells seashells by the seashore at Sally's Seashore Seashell Shop.
The shells Sally sells are surely spectacular and stupendous seashells.
Sick of substandard, scratched, slimy, and smelly seashells?
Seashells at Sally's Seashore Seashell Shop shine supreme, shiny, super shells.
Shapely shells.
Scarce shells.
Smooth and striking shells sold.
Sally's Seashore Seashell Shop sells seasonally on Saturdays and Sundays, starting at 7 to sundown.
Sally's shells certainly sound spectacular. Such significant savings on sensational shore seashells.
Sally's successful Sandy Shore Side Shop shares a sweet supply of select shell specimens at super savings. Seriously, save significant sums on shells scarcely seen.
Are you struggling and sorely scavenging sun-scorched sandy shores for substandard shells? Stop suffering. Spend summers sunning and sipping sweet sensations and swimming and surfing.
Send Sally's Seashore Seashell Shop staff shoreside, so shell supplies are skillfully and strenuously searched and selected. Shells are shined, scanned, and shipped systematically.
Sally's shop sources shells that searchers spend centuries scavenging on select shores and seeks and safely supplies strictly superior shells. 17 serious seashell selectors store and stock shiploads of striking specimens.
Sally's Seashore Seashell Shop certifies 77 specific shell styles, some special stained, striped, and streaked shells, sourced somewhere in southern Spain and stocked in shallow streams and shipped secretly.
Sometimes, several scary sharks swim the streams and surround the secret shell storages, shocking and sacrificing safety of Sally's Seashell Selection staff.
Sally's staff are certified swimmers. Strongest and swifter swimmers survive. Scary situation.
So show support and see Sally's Seashore Seashell Shop soon. Say, Sally sent ya.
Oh.
Disintegrating, and the pages have disintegrated. And I fortunately was able to get other copies, not quite as decorative, but when one of my friends, when she had heard me play this song, and she bought it so that when I came to her house, I could play it every time. The other thing about this piece that's special to me, my piano teacher used to have a memory contest every year, so you get a trophy for the most measures memorized. And I always came in first or second. But even back then, if you asked me to play anything by memory, I didn't know anything. but except Midnight Fire Alarm, through the years,
I knew probably the first two pages by memory, although I will say it just kind of went down to about two lines after a while. But I don't know why this piece, it stuck with me out of the thousands of measures that I memorized, you know, over the years. But it did. When they were talking about the variety show, I thought, I think it's time to do Midnight Fire Alarm. I was now thinking that maybe not was a good idea. Wasn't such a great idea. So this is a piece that's by Harry Lincoln and arranged by E.T. Paul, but this is going to be my rendition, which, think not of the horses that the new young horses racing to the fire, but perhaps the older horses, the older fire engine. It probably will make it to the fire, but it's not the first responder. Occasionally they have to slow down a little when an orbit speeds up and starts stumbling. Yeah, I gotta slow down. Or occasionally might get a little distracted by the scenery along the way, so they'll be kind of like, oh yeah, wait, we're going to a fire. I have not performed this or played this piece in public in many, many years, so for better, and usually better doesn't happen until about 10 times through, so I should have started like an hour ago, maybe. But for better or worse, here is the Midnight Fire Alarm.
Thank you. you. You guys ready?
Sure.
Here we go.
The more we get together, 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 the more we get together, the happier we'll be. For your friends are my friends, and my friends are your friends. The more we get together, the happier we'll be. The more we get together.
Long ago, it seems so long ago, I thought I'd made us
being here with us tonight and enjoying the fellowship, the food, and the entertainment. I believe one of the things we have in common here, though, is too, that we're all Lutheran. And how do you tell? Can you walk down the street and know who's Lutheran? Who isn't? Well, what I have for you here is a whole collection of things. You might be a Lutheran if. You might be a Lutheran if your definition of a contemporary hymn is one written in the 1800s. You might be a Lutheran if you tap a visitor on the shoulder and say, "Excuse me, but you're sitting in my seat." You might be a Lutheran if all your casserole dishes have your name on the bottom. You might be a Lutheran if it takes four people to change a light bulb, one to do it, and three to say, "We've never done it that way before." And you might be a Lutheran if you consider old-time gospel music upbeat. You might be a Lutheran if, while watching Star Wars, you hear, "May the Force be with you," and you reply, "And also with you." You might be a Lutheran if you feel guilty about not feeling guilty. You might be a Lutheran if you catch yourself saying amen at the end of the Pledge of Allegiance. And finally, you might be a Lutheran if your idea of a mixed marriage is an ELCA bride and a Missouri City groom. Well, that's all we have for you in entertainment tonight, folks. However, I think, Pastor, short benediction.